my topic for today is reversal of null anticoagulants. So these are the topics that I'm going to cover. I'm going to just briefly tell you about the new agents, oral agents. And I'm just going to mainly concentrate on dabigatran, which is the main, which is the only null agent that we use in New Zealand. I'm just going to tell you briefly about how to interpret the coagulation results in patients on dabigatran, and also a little bit about how to reverse it. And a small topic on dealing in patients on other types of oral agents. And we don't have oral penicillin inhibitors in New Zealand, but there are a few patients on it. Some cardiologists have access to some null agents. So broadly speaking, there are two main categories of new agents. They call it novel agents, novel or direct oral anticoagulants. So as I said, there are two main categories. Dabigatran inhibits the thrombin enzyme in the coagulation pathway, and there are three other drugs which inhibit Pen-A. But in New Zealand, only dabigatran is funded. It's funded for patients with DVT and also AF. I think there are three advantages of using oral agents, new oral agents. First of all, is it's effective. It works as well as warfarin. It doesn't need blood monitoring. And the bleeding risk is much lower than warfarin. So there's no blood monitoring required. These are the three main benefits, I suppose. And our drug of choice now for anticoagulation is dabigatran and not warfarin. So we use warfarin only if we cannot use dabigatran. This is a diagram I downloaded from the internet. So this is the final step of the coagulation pathway. Fibrinogen gets converted to fibrin by thrombin. Dabigatran inhibits that final step. Fibrin, I suppose, is the backbone of the clot. And the 10A enzyme converts prothrombin to thrombin. And rivaroxaban and other 10A inhibitors inhibit the factor 10A. So these null agents act on the final two steps. Very briefly about the dabigatran, it's rapidly absorbed as soon as you take it. It's absorbed into the blood, and peak level happens after 2 hours of intake. The half-life is about 12 hours, it's easy to remember, and it's predominantly excreted by kidneys. That's very important. Other oral agents are not so renally dependent for clearance, but dabigatran is predominantly renally excreted. So we always look at creatinine before we start patients on dabigatran. If the creatinine is high, we try to avoid it. And one good thing about dabigatran is that it affects the coagulation system, and we can measure the dabigatran level in the blood. It affects APTT, prolongs the APTT, not always, but it does prolong most of the time. The effect is non-linear. And the other test that we use is dilute thrombin clocking time. I'm not sure whether you're able to see this. So dilute thrombin clocking time is very sensitive to dabigatran. So what we do with TCT is that we add thrombin to the blood and it makes the blood clot. And we use dilute thrombin, so which makes it very sensitive to dabigatran. So even small amount of dabigatran, the dilute thrombin clotting time gets prolonged. So that's very sensitive. It also affects the prothrombin ratio, but only at very high concentrations. Most of the time it's normal. And some hospitals can do dabigatran assays. All three hospitals in Auckland can do dabigatran assays. And so there are two measurements, trough level and peak level, depending on when you take the blood sample. And it's measured in nanograms per liter or micrograms per liter. And this tells you about clinical correlation between the laboratory finding and the bleeding risk on surgery. So here we have the APTT, TCT. Don't worry about the dabigatran level. So if the TCT is normal, that means that there is no dabigatran in the system. So and you can safely do even lumbar punctures. We do not recommend doing lumbar punctures or spinal procedures if the TCT is abnormal. So TCT is first thing that we look at. So if the TCT is normal, we can do lumbar punctures, spinal procedures. If it is mildly prolonged, 20 to 80, if the APD is normal, that means that there is some dabigatran in the system, but not high enough, and more surgeries are safe. So we say, proceed with surgery. The surgery is going to be under general anesthesia. Please do not do spinal. That's our recommendation. If the TCT is more than 80, and yeah, I suppose these are the two scenarios with normal APD. The APD is elevated, that means that there's a significant amount of dabigatran, and we will say avoid surgery. If you want to do surgery, reverse it. And this is an example of a patient on dabigatran. APD is normal, PR is normal. Dabigatran doesn't affect the fibrinogen, so ignore that. Dilute TCT is prolonged. And we also, whenever we get a prolonged dilute TCT, we always do protamine correction. If it corrects on an addition of protamine, that means that there is heparin in the system. If it doesn't correct, that means dabigatran. And there is a dabigatran level at the bottom as well. Not very high. The good thing is that we now have reversal agent in New Zealand. I'm not sure whether all hospitals have it. We do have it in all hospitals in Middlemore, sorry, Auckland. It's called Daxvite, idarucimab. So basically, it comes in a box with two vials, and each vial has got 2.5 grams of Daxvite in it. And it's given us a quick IV push, and it's rapidly effective. It reverses dabigatran within minutes. And what does it do? It basically binds to dabigatran. It's similar to the digoxin antibody. It binds to dabigatran, and it's a small molecule. It doesn't have any intrinsic procoagulant or anticoagulant property, so it's very effective in reversing it. It has a very short half-life. So this is dabigatran, it's a small molecule, and that's Praxbind. This is thrombin. So the affinity of dabigatran to Praxbind is much higher than it is to thrombin. So this is the, this graph shows the effect of Praxbind in healthy volunteers. So on the vertical axis is this dilute thrombin clotting time, it's prolonged. And as soon as you give Praxbind, the TCT becomes normal. At various doses, 2 grams and 4 grams. So even 2 grams is effective. And if you don't give, if you just give placebo, the TCT slowly comes down to normal after 12 to 24 hours. So even if you do nothing, it will still reverse the dabigatran effect if you wait long enough. But if you want rapid reversal, we can use Praxbind. And this is the effect of Praxbind in patients with renal impairment. It works even in patients with renal impairment. It works in patients who are elderly. So this bit is Praxbind, the three groups. If you don't give anything, it slowly drops to normal levels. So it's very rapid, within minutes. You can see the reversal. So this drug was trialed, and we took part in that trial. It's called Reverse AD trial. It's now complete. Gordon Rowell, who was supposed to do the talk today, could not be here. So she took part in the study. He was the main investigator. He was the Middlemore was the lead hospital for the entire country, and there were. Praxbind was trialed in two groups, basically. The first group were bleeding patients, and you needed a rapid reversal of dabigatran. The second group needed emergency surgery. And both groups received 5 grams of Praxbind, and various blood tests were done after the infusion, just to check the clotting profile. The primary endpoint for this study was the coagulation, normalization of the coagulation profile, and the secondary endpoint was time to cessation of bleeding. In surgery patients, hemostasis during surgery was the secondary endpoint. So basically, it was a simple study, single arm, open label, a very broad inclusion criteria, and the primary endpoint was coagulation. Very simple to do. So these are the demographics and various data. Most patients were elderly, 77 was the average age group, and many of them had renal impairment. So high risk for bleeding patients. And this graph shows the effect of Braxbind. So here, you've got the dilute thrombin clotting time before the administration of the Braxbind, and as soon as you administer it, it normalizes. Just note here, this is 24 hours after infusion, there's a slight increase in the level of DTCT. I'll come to that a bit later. So basically, this shows that Braxbind is effective. And this shows time to cessation of bleeding according to the principle, according to the physician. Interestingly, the time to cessation of bleeding was 9.8 hours. That's rather long. And most of the patients had GI bleeds, some had intracranial bleeds. So it's very difficult. The reason for that is it's very difficult for a physician to determine whether the bleeding has stopped. Because bleeding is internal. How do you know whether the bleeding has stopped? So you rely, for example, if the patient has GI bleeding, the patient might still have melena even after the bleeding has stopped. So that's the reason why it's long. It's 9.8 hours. This is the group B patients, patients who had surgery, and normal hemostasis was achieved in more than 90% of the patients. And this data is interesting. Median time to surgery was 1.7 hours. So it's effective. Basically, this slide shows the safety data. The drug is safe. Many patients had clots after the reversal. That's because of the fact that the patient was not on any anticoagulation. And that was the reason. This shows a few other safety data. There were 26 deaths. These patients are they had life-threatening bleeding, so it's not unexpected that many deaths happened in both groups. Basically, this drug is effective. That's what this trial shows. The trial is now complete, so it's now funded in New Zealand 2 months ago. And Middlemore has got significant experience. Gordon Roll was the main investigator, as I mentioned. We provided 30% of the patients worldwide. And I think 500 patients were included, approximately 150 from the country. All sorts of indications, bleeding patients, surgery patients, but there are also some convenient surgical indications. The practical issues we encountered was there was a high incidence of non-compliance. Many patients were not taking dabigatran, and some patients were bleeding because of some other problem, not because of anticoagulation. A few cases of clots after the reversal. That's because they were not protected. Interestingly, we found that 24 hours after the reversal, we found an increase in the DTCT level or dabigatran level. That's because of the fact that many patients had renal impairment and there was some redistribution of dabigatran 24 hours after the reversal. That's something to be aware of. We would definitely advise patients for a like test 24 hours after reversal, just to look for this phenomena. And you can repeat the dose if required. So basically, there are three steps for reversal. If the patient is bleeding and it's life-threatening bleeding, of course, you can reverse it without waiting for the laboratory results. But if you have time, we will definitely want patients to have a blood test, clotting blood test, just to make sure that they have a divergential effect. And if you've got these two criteria, severity and evidence of divergential effect, you can proceed with the reversal. But it needs hematology approval, I think. But don't forget about supportive measures, things like fluids, red cell transfusions, tranexamic acid, etc., etc. And monitor for redistribution 24 hours after the reversal, especially in patients with renal impairment. This also shows the same thing. Life-threatening bleeding, proceed with reversal without waiting for the clotting results. If you want to do spinal procedures, it's preferable that you do the clotting measurements before you proceed with this procedure. If you can't do TCT for some reason, then you can reverse it without having to wait for the result. In all of the cases, it's preferable that you do the coagulation test and reverse it as if you think it is required. So basically, PlaxBind comes in a box, as I mentioned, two vials in it. It is costly; it's $5,000. So, and we believe that one vial is sufficient. I showed a graph before; 2 grams was as effective as 4 grams. So one vial is sufficient. So we usually say that please use only one vial, unless if the patient has renal impairment or massively bleeding. Then we will say, okay, use 2 vials, but most of the time we say just use 1 vial. And blood bank used to treat PlaxBind as a blood product. So what used to happen was we used to, okay, 1 vial, but blood bank will discard the 2nd vial. So that's not happening anymore. At least in the middle more, we are packaging, pharmacies packaging vials separately. So we now have 1 vial boxes. So you can request it just as 1 vial. Because it's very expensive, that's why we thought we should use only 1 vial. So that's all about dabigatran. So I'm just going to talk about oral anti-kinase inhibitors. One crucial thing to remember is that coagulation assays will be normal most of the time. And normal coagulation assays does not rule out the presence of anticoagulant. PR could be prolonged, especially if it's tested within 4 hours of the intake, but it does depend on the reagent that we use for measuring PR. Anti-kinase will measure the drug effect, but that test is not available everywhere. Hence, normal coagulation profile does not exclude presence of anticoagulants. That's very important. How do you reverse anti-10A agents? Basically, we don't have a specific reversal agent. We rely on supportive measures, fluids, blood transfusion, tranexamic acid. Some hematologists do recommend prothrombinase, but it's unproven. I will not recommend it. I will just recommend supportive measures. Of course, we do have other types of anti-10A inhibitors. Heparin, for example, you can reverse heparin with protamine. Can reverse 1/3 of flexane effect with protamine, but protamine is not effective here. So supportive measures only. But there is a promising drug in the horizon called andexanate. It's supposed to be a very good drug to reverse all the oral agents, anti-10A agents, but not yet available. Still being trialed. It's costly, it's $20,000. So this is the final slide. Basically, dabigatran is the only drug available to us, and we are quite familiar with dabigatran, and we're quite familiar with the coagulation profile of patients under rejection, and we can manage patients who are bleeding with a very very effective Praxbind drug. But you use it wisely, please, because it's expensive. At this stage, it's still gatekept by the hematologist. If you need to use it, if the case is urgent, life-threatening, use it without having to wait for the blood test. But we prefer that you wait for the blood test.